Today, The Existence of God, Part 14. And for more information and resources, go to reasonablefaith.org.
Well, we've been talking in class about arguments for God's existence, and we have a new outline for the next section on the teleological argument. Oh, the argument map. Okay, let's first distribute the argument map for the Kalam cosmological argument, which we have just finished. And then we should also have an outline for the teleological argument, which is the argument to be discussed. Now, while those outlines are being distributed, let's take a step back and reconnoiter and get the big picture of where we are. We began our survey of Christian doctrine with the doctrine of revelation. And then we moved to the doctrine of God. And we first had a lengthy examination of the attributes of God, in which we talked about what God is like. Then we began a section on what's called natural theology, which explores what we can know about the existence and nature of God apart from divine revelation in Scripture through human reflection, human reason alone. And in our excursus on natural theology that we have been embarked upon, we first looked at the contingency argument for God's existence that Gottfried Wilhelm Leibniz defended. And then after the contingency argument, we looked at the Kalam cosmological argument, which has a rich Jewish and Muslim history as well as Christian background. And having now completed the Kalam argument, we're ready to turn to our new argument, which is the teleological argument. And this comes from the Greek word telos, which means purpose or end or goal. And this is the famous argument for design. It's an argument for a cosmic designer of the world. This is one of the oldest arguments for God's existence. The ancient Greek philosophers, Plato and Aristotle, each defended versions of the teleological argument. According to Plato, there are two things that lead people to believe in God. The argument from the existence of the soul, which we haven't looked at, and then he said the argument from the order of the motion of the stars and of all things under the dominion of the mind, which ordered the universe. The order of the motion of the stars and of all things under the dominion of the mind, which ordered the universe. And Plato referred to this mind that orders the cosmos as the maker and father of all, the king who is the source of the rational cosmos in which we live. His pupil Aristotle has an even more splendid statement of the argument for design. Aristotle imagined what it would be like if there were a race of men who lived underground all their lives in a cave and who suddenly, through an earthquake or something, managed to escape and come out and see the external world. And this is how Aristotle describes the impact that seeing the world would have upon these men. He says, when thus they would suddenly gain sight of the earth, seas, and the sky, when they should come to know the grandeur of the clouds and the might of the winds, when they should behold the sun and should learn its grandeur and beauty as well as its power to cause the day by shedding light over the sky. And again, when the night had darkened the lands, and they should behold the whole of the sky spangled and adorned with stars, and when they should see the changing lights of the moon as it waxes and wanes, and the risings and settings of all these celestial bodies, their courses fixed and changeless throughout all eternity, when they should behold all these things, most certainly they would have judged both that there exist gods and that all these marvelous works are the handiwork of the gods. In his book, The Metaphysics, Aristotle goes on to argue that there must be one first uncaused cause, a prime mover, a first uncaused cause, which he refers to as God, a living, intelligent, immaterial, eternal, and most good being who is the source of order in the cosmos. And as you read the works of these ancient Greek philosophers, like Plato and Aristotle, you cannot help but think of Paul's letter to the church in Rome, where in chapter 1 and verse 19, he says, "Ever since the creation of the world, God's invisible nature, namely his eternal power and deity, has been clearly perceived in the things that have been made." From the earliest times, men who are totally ignorant of biblical revelation have looked at the order and beauty in nature and inferred that there must be a designer and God who has created the universe. And today, many astronomers are coming to a similar conclusion. Scientists used to think that whatever the initial conditions of the universe might have been, eventually, given enough time and some luck, that intelligent creatures like us would evolve somewhere in the cosmos. But in fact, as a result of discoveries over the last 40 or 50 years, what has happened is that we now know that that assumption was wrong. In fact, the exact opposite turns out to be true. What astronomers have discovered is that the initial conditions of the universe in the Big Bang had to be finely tuned to a precision and delicacy that literally defies human comprehension if intelligent life forms are to evolve anywhere in the cosmos. And this delicate balance of initial conditions present in the Big Bang has come to be known as the fine tuning of the universe. From its earliest inception, the universe appears to be fine-tuned for the existence of intelligent life with a precision and delicacy that are literally incomprehensible. Now, there are two kinds of fine-tuning. The first involves what are called the constants of nature, and the second involves certain arbitrary quantities that characterize the universe. So let me say a word about each of these. First, the constants of nature. What is a constant? Well, when the laws of nature are expressed as mathematical equations, you find appearing in them certain symbols which stand for unchanging quantities. For example, the force of gravity, the gravitational constant, or the electromagnetic force, or the subatomic weak force. So, for example, take Newton's gravitational law, that to calculate gravitational force, you take the gravitational constant G, and you multiply this by the masses of the two bodies that are attracting each other. If you have two masses, say 1 and 2, to figure out the gravitational force between them, you take the gravitational constant times the mass of these two objects divided by the distance between them squared, which we can symbolize as R. And of course, the masses of the objects may vary. They may be two planets, they may be two billiard balls, they may be a billiard ball and a planet. Those can vary. The distance obviously varies depending on how far apart the objects are. But G is a constant. It always has the same value. And the values of these constants are not determined by the laws of nature. There could be universes that are governed by exactly the same law. You could have the same force law, but G could take some other value. The value of G is independent of the law of nature in which it occurs. G could have any of a wide range of values, and the law would still be the same. And you would have a different kind of universe, obviously, if you change the value of G. So you could have universes which are governed by the same law, but have different values of the constants. And these universes would look very different from our universe. So the actual value that G has is not determined by the laws of nature. It's independent of the laws of nature. And depending on what value these constants take, the universe will look very different. Well, let me give some examples of fine-tuning, because physics abounds with examples of fine-tuning. But before I do so, let me give you some numbers to give you a feel for the delicacy of the fine-tuning, because otherwise the numbers are just so large they become meaningless to us. The number of seconds in the history of the universe from the very beginning of the universe is about 10 to the 17th power. Now that's 1 followed by 17 zeros. Just an incomprehensible number. That's the number of seconds in the history of the universe. The number of subatomic particles in the entire known universe is around 10 to the 80th power. Now, with those numbers in mind, consider the following. The atomic weak force, which operates within the nucleus of the atom, is so finely tuned that an alteration of even one part out of 10 to the 100th power would have rendered the universe life prohibiting. In order to permit life, the weak force has to be fine-tuned to one part out of 10 to the 100th power. Similarly, the so-called cosmological constant, which drives the acceleration of the universe, has to be fine-tuned to with one part out of 10 to the 120th power in order for the universe to be life-permitting. Here's a real corker. Roger Penrose of Oxford University has estimated that the initial entropy condition, the entropy level of the early universe, has to be fine-tuned to one part out of 10 to the power of 10 to the power of 123, a number which is so incomprehensible that to call it astronomical would be a wild understatement. And it's not just one of these numbers that must be fine-tuned, but all of them, so that you multiply these probabilities together until our minds are just reeling in incomprehensible numbers. Having an accuracy of even one part out of 10 to the 60th power, one part out of 10 to the 60th power, would be like having a range the size of the entire visible universe, 20 billion light years across. And in order for life to exist, a randomly thrown ball, say, would have to land in an area 1 inch in length. So imagine a 20 billion light year distance. In order for life to exist, just a randomly thrown ball would have to land within this specific 1 inch square. And that's just 1 out of 10 to the 60th. And we're talking about numbers that are just unimaginably greater than that. And this is just some of the examples of fine-tuning. The examples of fine-tuning are so many and so various that they're unlikely to disappear with the further advance of science. Like it or not, the fine-tuning of the universe for life is just a scientific fact, which is well established.